Today we're doing villain therapy on Severus Snape, but should it be villain therapy?
I'm the half-blood prince.
Your father was a swine.
Protego!
Is his love for Lily tragic, unrequited love, or is it an unhealthy obsession? The image of Snape cradling Lily's body is just one of the saddest things that's ever been put on film. That is freaking beautiful.
After all this time, always.
He bullies kids. He's still a villain.
It's just the one kid. That
it's
he,
just the one
he
kid
just
that
tortures
he bullies.
The one kid. That's the, and I'm like, what are you say it out loud?
Hello and welcome to Cinema Therapy. I'm Jonathan Decker and I love movies. I'm also a therapist.
I'm Alan. Seawright, professional filmmaker, and I love movies also because I'm a professional filmmaker, but I need therapy is the important part.
Yes, and today we are doing villain therapy on Severus Snape, but should it be villain therapy? Like, I'm kind of leaning towards psychology of a hero. After all, like, he does a lot to
he
bring down...
He bullies children. He's a villain. I will die on this hill.
Oh. Villain therapy it is.
Okay.
So here we go. So the thing about villain therapy, just like our Psychology of a Hero series, is our favorite characters struggle with some of the things that we struggle with. As always, there is no correlation between mental illness and villainy.
Correct.
But villains can have mental health struggles.
Correct.
Now, Snape is a sympathetic villain.
More so in the movies than the books, but even in the books, you know, he gets a little redemption at the end.
Yes. And I, having recently reread the books, I was like, oh wow, I like him so much more in the movies.
Part of that's the whole Alan Rickman of it all.
Yeah.
You've just bought yourself a month's detention, McLagan. Not so quick, Potter.
Even though we've established that he is a villain, is his love for Lily tragic, unrequited love, or is it an unhealthy obsession? Is his mistreatment of the students balanced by his bravery and his heroic deeds? Come on, man. We got to
give opinions. We're going to discuss. We're going to learn.
I think I'm much more sympathetic to Snape because I deal with, let's say, difficult people sometimes for a living.
Okay.
And I see that there's still people underneath that doesn't justify the behavior.
God bless you. You got a f***ing gift.
No, I don't.
Yes, you do.
I really don't.
Yes, you do.
So you could probably expect a more compassionate take from me, whereas Alan...
I do not feel compassion for anyone.
No, not for anyone, for Snape.
Anyone.
Oh, man.
Sentiment is a chemical defect found in the losing side.
And what does the fact that we are meant to have compassion for him ultimately do for his character arc overall?
Okay.
So let's take a look, and we are expecting you all to have a lot of feelings and a lot of comments.
I'm going to cry a lot.
Let's do this.
There will be no foolish wand waving or silly incantations in this class.
What if they burst through the door like Kramer?
As such, I don't expect many of you to appreciate the subtle science and exact art that is potion making. However, for those select few,
looks right at Malfoy,
who possess the predisposition, I can teach you how to bewitch the mind and ensnare the senses.
There is no one like Rickman on Earth, man.
I miss him so much.
Brew glory and even put a stopper in death.
Death.
However.
Then again. Maybe some of you have come to Hogwarts in possession of abilities so formidable that you feel confident enough to not pay attention.
So built-in bias, because he already sees James.
Yep.
Which is a shame.
Mr. Potter, our new celebrity. Tell me, what would I get if I added powdered root of asphodel to an infusion of wormwood?
I'm going to bring up a thing all the Potterheads know about, but we'll save it for the end of the scene.
Well, let's try again. Where, Mr. Potter, would you look if I asked you to find me a bezoar?
All due respect to your wife, I envision her being like that in school. Maybe not wanting to share, but definitely knowing.
Oh, yeah. No, she wasn't raising her hand, but she knew the whole time. Yeah, that was Megan.
I don't know, so.
Except Megan's prettier than Emma Watson.
Well played. Clearly,
fame isn't everything, is it, Mr. Potter?
So, you know, quick Potterhead note. All of you Potterheads are going to be like, duh, we already know this. But for everyone else, powdered asphodel, it's a type of lily commonly associated with death or passing. And wormwood is commonly associated with bitterness or grief. So he's bitter about Lily's passing. He's hitting it right up front. J.K. Rowling's real good at writing stuff.
Yeah.
Not great at, you know,
some
other
relations
things.
Or other. We'll leave it there. We'll just leave that there. We're going to focus on the work. We're going to focus on the work.
Focus on the work.
But yes, he's up front acknowledging his bitterness about Lily's death. And I wonder, I mean, obviously that's a literary device, but I wonder if Snape as a character is choosing this because he sees Harry and he thinks of Lily.
I'm sure that is what's happening.
You know. Thank you, Albert, for sponsoring this episode.
Albert? Who's Albert? I don't know anyone named Albert, and you're holding up a card. Anyway, thanks, Albert, I guess.
It's not a person named Albert. It's an app, and it's completely different from any bank account you've ever used before.
Ooh, right. That Albert.
Yes, this Albert. You know how most banks charge you fees for having a checking and savings account?
I do know that.
Albert is free to sign up and easy to use.
I like both of those things. And you know how banks don't give you cash back on debit card purchases? With your Albert debit card, you can get cash back, which is smart.
You just tap on your favorite merchant in the app, not an actual person, and you can get 5 to 20% cash back on purchases like groceries, gas, and more.
Movies?
Probably. Just swipe your card and you'll see money show up immediately in your account. Ching, ching.
Managing finances is hard and or stressful.
Two things my wife describes me as.
That's why Albert has a team of financial experts they call geniuses and or savants.
Just geniuses.
That can answer any question and will look at your situation and finances and help you make a plan and or strategy.
By supporting Albert, you're supporting our channel, folks.
Click the link in the description box or go to albert.com/cinematherapy to download the Albert app today.
That's albert.com/cinematherapy. For a limited time, when you open a checking account and connect a qualifying direct deposit, you'll get $150.
Did you just cut yourself with an Albert card? It's not a batarang.
So here's a question, because you're a director of actors. A lot of times, especially in today's modern world, it's all about pacing.
Yeah.
And there are certain moments you want to let breathe, but usually you want to keep things moving or people get bored.
I am very much in this camp. I like things to clip along at a good speed.
And Alan Rickman is the polar opposite.
Yep.
Every word takes a while.
You just know.
He takes interesting pauses at different places. And here's the thing. If I had ever gotten the chance to direct Alan Rickman, here's what I would have done as a director. Continue.
Just, yes. Why does it work for him?
Honestly, I don't know.
But it does.
It works like gangbusters. And it's something that shouldn't work because it should be boring.
But he commands such authority because if someone spoke like that in real life, I'd be tempted to interrupt them. I'd be like, okay, well, we're moving on. But with Rickman, you're just like, we're just going to wait till he's...
We're just waiting.
Don't lie to me.
And he's not always, you know, Snape is like maximum Rickman, but he does it in everything.
Yeah.
This is just a lot of it. I honestly couldn't tell you what it is. That's the magic of a great actor is, I don't know why it works. I don't know why Christopher Walken being... just all over the place.
Yeah.
Is fantastic, but it is.
5 long years he wore this watch up his ass. Then he died of dysentery.
So we see he has it against Harry from the start.
Oh, he's immediately bullying him to the point where he's blinding himself to, like, Harry was actually the best student in there.
Yeah.
Aside from Hermione, who's always the best student.
Well, Harry was definitely the most attentive.
Sure.
Harry was there to learn. He's
taking notes.
Yeah, and Harry didn't have anything against Snape until right out of the gate.
Yeah.
And this speaks to me about sometimes we meet family members or friends of people that we despise and we're automatically, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Or they have this specific role or this specific position, and we automatically assume things. And Snape shoots himself in the foot. I mean, he's so bitter, and he just seems, at this point, he just sees James when he looks at Harry. This is an opportunity to get revenge on his bully by bullying that bully's son.
Yeah.
That's healthy.
He's a villain.
Once again, coming in like Kramer, coming in hot.
Turn to page 394.
You see how quickly he turned and then stopped? It's like a figure skater. It's like...
Werewolves?
I love the Juan sounds in this film that aren't in the other ones. There's definitely a more haunting echo to it in this particular film.
How disappointing.
Very fluty.
Please, sir. An animagus is a wizard who elects to turn into an animal. A werewolf has no choice. With each full moon, when he transforms, he no longer remembers who he is. He'd kill his best friend if he crossed his path.
That is the second time you've spoken out of turn, Miss Granger. Are you incapable of restraining yourself, or do you take pride in being an insufferable know-it-all?
Oh, man.
Good point, you know.
5 points.
He's not wrong, you know, is what Ron says.
As an antidote to your ignorance, and on my desk by Monday morning, 2 rolls of parchment on the werewolf, with particular emphasis on recognizing it.
Sir, it's Quidditch tomorrow.
Then I suggest you take extra care, Mr. Potter. Loss of limb will not excuse you. Page 394.
Someone who's the best in their field would be the best to teach. Not always the case.
I would actually much rather learn from a person who's a good teacher who's only reading ahead on the source material 1 or 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And just barely knows more than you.
Yeah.
Than someone who is an absolute expert in the field and a completely terrible tat.
There's a great book that I read called Made to Stick, where it talks about making your ideas sticky so that when you say something, people remember it. And one of the things it talks about is called the curse of knowledge. The curse of knowledge is once you've learned something and you are immersed in it enough that it's part of you, you forget what it was like not to know it.
Right.
And so it's really hard to teach because you get impatient with people who are learning it and who don't grasp it the way you do, don't have the experience that you have. And Snape is nothing if not impatient. And
that's Can I just take a moment to give you the best backhanded compliment I think I've ever come up with?
Sure.
You do not have the curse of knowledge. And what I mean by that is Jonathan is obviously
knows
an excellent teacher and obviously clearly knows his stuff. So even though you know your stuff and are deeply immersed in it, you still make it accessible to all these wonderful people on the internet.
Thank you.
So you're not cursed with knowledge.
Thank you.
I meant that sincerely, but also I couldn't resist it.
No, that was beautiful. I try to be like the X-lax of instruction to just make everything just like pass right.
There you have it, folks. Jonathan Decker, LMFT, not cursed with knowledge, human X-lax.
Gosh. Oh, that was beautiful.
Oh, boy.
Okay. Okay, so coming back to it, here's something that I noticed reading the books. One of the reasons Snape is arguably a much more sympathetic figure in the movies is they de-emphasize what a bully he is to everyone but Harry. This is one of the very few scenes I can think of where he singles out somebody else.
Oh, from the films. Yeah, he doesn't do it a lot. It's mostly just Harry.
In the films, he singles out Hermione here, you know, for being an insufferable know-it-all, which is one of my favorite put-downs, especially as delivered by Rickman. But in the books, man, he's awful to Neville. He's awful to Hermione, to the point of, like, making kids cry.
Yep.
It's much clearer in the books that he is flat-out a terrible person.
Right.
There is room in the movies for kind of what the movies play into, which is that this was mostly a front. That he is annoyed with Harry, that he does see James in him, but that he's secret.
But maybe underneath there's some caring and
a little bit
of compassion. He doesn't want Harry to fail.
And he doesn't hate his students. Like, in the movies, there's more room for him to be heroic, like actually heroic, which is why people who've only seen the movies tend to land more on he's secretly a hero.
Yeah.
If you've read the books, you're like, no, he's an
He's a real piece of work.
Yeah. Win a lunch date with Alan and I, either in person or online. Play our Cinema Therapy Trivia online game. Link is in the description. We'll see you there.
Or we won't.
If you lose.
Loser.
Gosh.
You're just like your father. Lazy. Arrogant.
Don't say a word against my father.
Weak.
I'm not weak.
Then prove it. Control your emotions. Discipline your mind.
Because in the movies, you could very much read this as he does want to protect Harry.
He's pushing him to protect him.
He's being a jerk about it, but it's tough love.
I may vomit.
Stop it!
Is this what you call control?
We've been at it for hours. If I could just rest!
The Dark Lord isn't resting.
I love that little grimace of you're so disgusting.
Two of a kind, sentimental children forever whining about how bitterly unfair your lives have been. Well, it may have escaped your notice, but life isn't fair. Your blessed father knew that. In fact, he frequently sought
my father was a great man.
Your father was a swine.
Well, Protego!
He looks so much like Guy of Gisborne in Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves, like that actor.
Oh, yeah.
Nice one, James.
Would you like to finish him off?
Dad.
Impedimenta.
Shocking revelation, my father was a bully.
Snibbly's trout.
Enough. Your lessons are at an end. Get out.
Just the hate in his eyes there.
Yeah. And at that point, it's like, is it for Harry? Is it for James? I have a question for you about book to movie adaptations. First of all,
they're super easy.
I get super tired in general, but especially with Harry Potter, of the books are better than the movies. First of all, what they pulled off in 10 years, 7 books, 8 films, 10 years with a cast that was children when they started, rapidly aging, with a series that wasn't even finished when they started filming, so they didn't know exactly what they were doing, and an author who wasn't going to tell the directors, here's exactly what we're doing, is incredible.
A nearly unmatched achievement in filmmaking. It's unreal what they did.
And Harry Potter, I'll describe Harry Potter the way you describe Marvel, is that there are some great ones in there.
And none of them are bad.
And none of them are bad.
Yeah.
There are some that are better than others, but none of them are bad. So first of all, put that to bed. Second thing is, stories change.
Harry, you put your name in a goblet of fire.
Stories have to get streamlined. Characters have to be grafted together.
Yeah.
Spielberg, for example, said about Jaws that the characters were so unlikable that he was rooting for the shark.
Yes.
About the book. So he like scrapped most of the
book. Have you ever read that book?
It's terrible.
Ugh.
Yeah.
Trash. The movie's so good.
Yeah. And so there's some character work that has to change. And two things I see. One, Snape is much more relatable throughout.
Yeah.
And so is Sirius Black. Sirius Black is just as bitter. And frankly, reading the books, unlikable as Snape. Now, I get it. Like, he's broken and damaged and traumatized, and so I don't blame the character. But they make both of these characters warmer and more approachable.
For the movies, it definitely served the movies, especially Gary Oldman's sort of turn to warmth, and it plays just beautifully. With Snape, if you had put on film what is in the book, it's just child abuse.
Yeah.
And we wouldn't have tolerated it.
Yeah.
We would have been like, Dumbledore is an idiot for having Snape around. Like, this, it by proxy would have ruined Dumbledore.
Yes.
Because why is this guy keeping this obvious child abuser around?
Right. And it's generally not physical abuse, and it's definitely not sexual abuse, but verbal emotional abuse is horrific.
Catastrophic.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, yeah, really bad.
Speaking of bullying children, can that lead to mental health problems if you've gone through it, if your kids are going through it?
I think probably, yeah.
Yes, absolutely. But what are those problems and what are the solutions? Check out this Men in Light video right here.
Check out this telekinesis video. It doesn't have anything to do with Harry Potter because I've never made a Harry Potter video before, but this one's funny. I don't know. Maybe you can look at it or watch it or something. Maybe.
No.
You're sent for me, headmistress.
Snape, yes. The time has come for answers, whether he wants to give them to me or not. Have you brought the Veritaserum?
I'm afraid you've used up all my stores interrogating students, the last of it on Miss Chang. Unless you wish to poison him, and I assure you I would have the greatest sympathy if you did. I cannot help you.
He's got Padfoot. He's got Padfoot at the place where it's hidden. Padfoot? What is Padfoot? Well, what is hidden? What is he talking about, Snape?
No idea.
But then, of course, he does send help.
Absolutely.
The big question is he... You know, in Rise of Skywalker, there's actually one line that is inarguably great in Rise of Skywalker, which is,
I don't care if you win. I need Kylo Ren to lose.
As far as Snape is concerned, does he really care about doing the right thing, undoing the damage that he's done, stopping the Death Eaters or bringing harmony to the world? Or does he just care about sticking it to Voldemort because of Lily's death?
Ultimately, doesn't matter.
No.
Intentions count for something, but, I mean, you've said this a lot. Intentions don't matter nearly as much as results,
yeah.
Right?
Or at least that there's a chasm between intention and result, and
right.
We can't consider them as one and the same, yeah, for sure.
Ultimately, whether he wants to do it to stand up for truth and righteousness and good, or I'm just sticking it to Voldemort, plus I've, you know, sworn an oath to Dumbledore, and, you know, if nothing else, he has integrity.
And that's the thing is, especially in the last couple films, we see some acting choices on Rickman's part where he is deciding to portray Snape as having not just a hidden life of bitterness and loss, but we're going to see, especially, I love that Alan Rickman is just kind of hanging out for about five films because...
Well, he's only working like 1 or 2 weeks per film. Like,
yeah.
He's not in the movies all that much.
And he's kind of hanging out and he sticks around because Rowling's like, it's going to be worth it. And
yeah.
Everybody knows that he's the only person who knew what his arc was going to be, and he wouldn't even tell the directors. But we see in the last couple films some really bold acting choices.
Mm-hmm.
Let's take a look.
On the next exciting episode of Cinema Therapy.
He never fought to sabotage Lillian James.
Right.
Or to claim her as his. So is his love for Lily a tragic, unrequited romance, or is it an unhealthy obsession?